Thank you for coming out for Shakespeare in the Grove 2014. Art Farm's production of King Lear.
I thought the king had more affected the Duke of Albany than Cornwall.
It did always seem so to us, but now in the division of the kingdom, it appears not which of the dukes he values most.
Is not this your son, my lord?
His breeding, sir, hath been at my charge. I have so often blushed to acknowledge him that now I am braised to it.
I cannot conceive you.
Sir, this young fellow's mother could, whereupon she grew round-wombed, and had, indeed, sir, a son for her cradle as she had a husband for her bed. But I have a son, sir, by order of law, some year elder than this, who yet is no dearer in my account, though this knave came something saucily into the world before he was sent for, yet was his mother fair. There was good sport at his making, and the horse son must be acknowledged. Do you know this noble gentleman, Edmund?
No, my lord.
My lord of Kent, remember him hereafter as my honorable friend.
My services to your lordship.
I must love you, and sue to know you better.
Sir, I shall study deserving.
The king's coming!
My Lord of Gloucester, attend the Princes France and Burgundy.
I shall, my liege.
Meantime, we shall express our darker purpose with the map. Here, know that we have divided in three our kingdom, and 'tis our fast intent to shake all cares and business from our age, conferring them on younger strengths, while we, unburdened, crawl toward death. Our son Cornwall, and you are no less loving son of Albany. We have this hour a constant will to publish our daughter's several dowers, that future strife may be prevented now. The great lords of France and Burgundy, great rivals in our youngest daughter's love, long in our courts have made their amorous sojourn, and here are to be answered. Tell me, my daughters, since now we will divest us both of rule, interests of territory, cares of state, which of you, shall we say, doth love us most, that we our largest bounty may extend? Goneril, speak first.
Sir, I love you more than words can wield the matter, dearer than eyesight, space, and liberty beyond what can be valued, rich or rare. No less than life with grace, health, beauty, honor, as much as child e'er loved or father found. A love that makes breath poor and speech unable. Beyond all manner of so much, I love you.
What shall Cordelia speak? Love and be silent.
of all these bows, even from this line to this, we make thee, lady. To thine and Albany's issue be this perpetual. Now, what says our second daughter, our dearest Regan, wife of Cornwall?
Sir, I am made of that self-metal as my sister, and prize me at her worth. In my true heart, I find she names the very deed of love, only she comes too short. That I profess myself an enemy to all other joys which the most precious square of sense possesses, and find I am alone felicitate in your dear highness's love.
To thee and thine, hereditary ever, remains this ample share of our fair kingdom. No less in space, validity, and pleasure than that conferred on Goneril. And now, our joy, although our last, not least, to whose young love the vines of France and milk of Burgundy strive to be interest. What can you say to draw a third more opulent than your sisters? Speak.
Nothing, my lord.
Nothing?
Nothing.
Nothing will come of nothing. Speak again.
Unhappy that I am, I cannot heave my heart into my mouth. I love your majesty according to my bond, no more nor less.
Oh, how? Cordelia, mend thy speech a little, lest you may mar your fortune.
Oh, good my lord, you have begot me, bred me, loved me, and I return those duties back as are right fit. Obey you, love you, and most honor you. Why have my sisters husbands if they say they love you all? Haply, when I shall wed, that lord whose hand must take my plight shall carry half my love with him, half my care and duty. Sure, I shall never marry like my sisters to love my father all.
But goes thy heart with this?
Ay, my good lord.
So young and so untender?
So young, my lord, and true.
Well, let it be so. Thy truth, then, be thy dower. I here disclaim all my paternal care, propinquity, property of blood, and as a stranger to my heart and me, hold thee from this forever, as thou cease to be my sometime daughter!
Good, my liege!
Peace, Kent! Come not between the dragon and his wrath. I loved her most, and thought to set my rest on her kind nursery. Hence and avoid my sight. Call France. Who stirs? Go Burgundy, Cornwall, Albany, with my two daughters' dowers digest this third. Let pride, which she calls plainness, marry her. I do invest you jointly with my power. Ourself by monthly course, with reservation of 100 knights by you to be sustained, shall our abode make with you by due turn. Only we shall retain the name and all the additions to a king, the sway, revenue, execution of the rest. Beloved sons, be yours, which to confirm this part betwixt you.
Royal Lear, loved as my father, as my master followed, as my great patron thought on in my prayers.
The bow is bent and drawn, make from the shaft.
Let it fall, rather, though the fork invade the region of my heart. Be Kent unmannerly when Lear is mad. What wouldst thou do, old man? Thinkest thou that duty shall have dread to speak? When power to flattery bows, reserve thy state, and in thy best consideration, check this hideous rashness. Thy youngest daughter does not love thee least.
Kent, on thy life, no more.
My life I never held but as a pawn to wage against thy enemies. Ne'er fear to lose it, thy safety being the motive.
Out of my sight.
See better, Lear, and let me still remain the true blank of thine eye.
Now by Apollo.
Now by Apollo, king, thou swearest thy gods in vain.
O vassal, miscreant.
Revoke thy doom. I'll tell thee thou dost evil.
Hear me, recreant. On thine allegiance. Hear me. 5 days we do allot thee for provisions, and on the sixth to turn thy hated back upon our kingdom. If on the tenth day following thy banished trunk be found in our dominion, the moment is thy death. Away! By Jupiter, this shall not be revoked.
Farewell, king, since thus thou wilt appear. Freedom lives hence, and banishment is here. The gods to their dear shelter take thee, maid, that justly thinkst and hast most rightly said.
And Burgundy, my noble lord.
My lord of Burgundy, we first address toward you, who with this king hath rivaled for our daughter. What in the least will you require in present dower with her, or cease your quest of love?
Most royal majesty, I crave no more than what your highness offered, nor will you tender less.
When she was dear to us, we did hold her so, but now her price is fallen, sir. There she stands, and nothing more.
I know no answer.
Will you, with those infirmities she owes, unfriended, new adopted to our hate, dowered with our curse, strangered with our oath, take her or leave her?
Pardon me, royal sir. Election makes not up on such conditions.
Then leave her, sir. For by the powers that made me, I tell thee all her wealth. For you, great king, I would not from your love make such a strait to match you where I hate. Therefore beseech you to avert your liking a more worthier way.
This is most strange, that she that even now is your best object, the argument of your praise, the balm of your age, the best, most dearest, should in this trice of time commit a thing so monstrous as to dismantle so many folds of favor. Sure, her offense must be of some unnatural degree.
I yet beseech your majesty, if what I want, that glib and oily art to speak and purpose not, that you make known it is no vicious blot, murder or foulness, no unchaste action or dishonored step that have deprived me of your grace and favor. But even for that for which I am richer, a still soliciting eye, and such a tongue as I am glad I have not, though not to have it hath lost me in your liking.
Better thou hadst never been born than not to have pleased me better.
Is it but this? A tardiness in nature that often leaves history unspoke as it intends to do. My lord of Burgundy, what say you to the lady? Will you have her? She is herself a dower.
Royal Lear, give but that portion which yourself proposed, and here I take Cordelia by the hand, Duchess of Burgundy.
Nothing, Burgundy, I am sworn, I am firm.
I am sorry, then, that you have so lost a father that you must lose a husband.
peace be with Burgundy. Since that respects of fortune are his love, I shall not be his wife.
Fairest Cordelia, that art most rich, being poor, most choice forsaken, and most loved despised. Thee and thy virtues here I seize upon. Be it lawful, I take up what is cast away. Gods, gods, 'tis strange that from their coldest neglect my love should kindle to inflamed respect. Thy dowerless daughter, king thrown to my chance, is queen of us, of ours, and our fair France. Not all the dukes of waterish Burgundy could buy this unprized, precious maid of me. Bid them farewell, Cordelia. Though unkind, thou losest here a better where to find.
Fall hands, let her be thine, for we have no such daughter, nor shall ever see that face of hers again. Therefore be gone without our grace, our love, our benison. Come, noble Burgundy.
Bid farewell to your sisters.
The jewels of our father, with washed eyes, Cordelia leaves you. Use well our father. To your professed bosoms I commit him. But yet, alas, stood I within his grace, I would prefer him to a better place. So farewell to you both.
Prescribe not us our duties.
Let your study be to content your lord, who hath received you at fortune's alms.
Come, fair Cordelia.
Sister, it is not a little I need to say of what most appertains to us both. I think our father will hence tonight.
That's most certain, and with you, next month with us.
You see how full of changes his age is. He always loved our sister most.
Such unconstant starts are we like to have from him as this of Kent's banishment.
Well, in the best and soundest of his time hath been but rash. There is further compliment of leave-taking between France and him. I pray you, let's hit together. If our father carry authority with us such dispositions as he bears, this last surrender of his will but offend us.
We'll further think on it.
We must do something. I'm in the heat.
Thou, nature, art my goddess. To thy law my services are bound. Wherefore should I stand in the plague of custom and permit the curiosity of nations to deprive me for that I am some 12 or 14 moonshines lag of a brother? Why, bastard? Wherefore base, when my dimensions are as well compact, my mind as generous, and my shape as true as honest madam's issue? Why brand they us with base, with baseness, bastardy, base, base, who in the lusty stealth of nature take more composition and fierce quality than doth within a dull, stale, tired bed go to the creating a whole tribe of fops got tween asleep and wake? Well then, legitimate Edgar, I must have your land. Our father's love is to the bastard Edmund as to the legitimate, fine word, legitimate. Well, my legitimate, if this letter speed and my invention thrive, Edmund the base shall top the legitimate. I grow, I prosper. Now, gods, stand up for bastards.
Kent banished thus, and France in color parted, and the king gone tonight. Edmund, how now, what news?
So please your lordship, none.
Why so earnestly seek you to put up that letter?
I know no news, my lord.
What paper were you reading?
Nothing, my lord.
No? What needed then that terrible dispatch of it into your pocket? Let's see, come, if it be nothing, I shall not need spectacles.
I beseech you, sir, pardon me. It is a letter from my brother that I have not all or read, and for so much as I have perused, I find it not fit for your or looking.
Give me the letter, sir.
I shall offend either to detain or give it. The contents, as in part I understand them, are to blame.
Let's see, let's see.
I hope for my brother's justification he wrote this, but as an essay or test of my virtue.
This policy and reverence of age makes the world bitter to the best of our times, keeps our fortunes from us till our oldness cannot relish them. I begin to find an idle and fond bondage in the oppression of aged tyranny, whose sway is not as it hath power, but as it is suffered. Come to me that of this I may speak more. If our father would sleep till I waked him, you should half his revenue forever and live the beloved of your brother, Edgar. Conspiracy? Sleep till I waked him, you should enjoy half his revenue? My son, Edgar? Had he a hand to write this, a heart and brain to breed it? When came this to you? Who brought it?
It was not brought me, my lord. There's the cunning of it. I found it thrown in at the casement of my closet.
You know the character to be your brother's.
If the matter were good, my lord, I durst swear it were his, but in respect of that, I would fain think it were not.
It is his!
It is his hand, my lord, but I hope his heart is not in the contents.
Had he never heretofore sounded you in this business?
Never, my lord. But I have heard him oft maintain it to be fit that sons at a perfect age and fathers declining, the father should be as ward to the son and the son manage his revenue.
Oh, villain! Villain! His very opinion in the letter! Abhorrent villain! Unnatural, detested, brutish villain! To his father, that so tenderly and entirely loves him. Abominable villain! These late eclipses of the sun and moon portend us no good. Love cools, friendship falls off, brothers divide, in cities and countries discord. Their son against father? We have seen the best of our time. Find out this villain, Edmund. It shall lose thee nothing.
I will seek him, sir, presently. Convey the business as I shall find means and acquaint you with all.
And the noble and true-hearted Kent banished his offense, honesty. Oh, 'tis strange.
This is the excellent foppery of the world, that when we are sick in fortune, often the surfeits of our own behavior, we make guilty of our disasters the sun, the moon and the stars, as if we were villains by necessity, fools by heavenly compulsion. My father compounded with my mother under the dragon's tail, and my nativity was under Ursa Major, so that it follows I am rough and lecherous. Tut! I should have been that I am had the maidenliest star twinkled on my bastardizing. Edgar, my cue is villainous melancholy with a sigh like Tom o' Bedlam. Oh, fasol ami.
How now, brother Edmund? What serious contemplation are you in?
Come. When saw you my father last?
Why, the night gone by.
Spake you with him?
Aye, 2 hours together.
Parted you in good terms? Found you no displeasure in him by word or countenance?
None at all.
Bethink yourself wherein you may have offended him, and at my entreaty forbear his presence till some little time hath cooled the heat of his rage and displeasure.
Some villain hath done me wrong.
That's my fear. I pray you till the speed of his rage go slower to my lodging. I pray you go. If you do stir abroad, go armed.
Armed, brother.
Brother, I advise you to the best, go armed. I be no honest man if there be any good meaning towards you.
Shall I hear from you anon?
I do serve you in this business. A credulous father and a brother noble, whose nature is so far from doing harms that he suspects none, on whose foolish honesty my practices ride easy. I see the business. Let me, if not by birth, have lands by wit. All with me's meat that I can fashion fit.
Did my father strike my gentleman for chiding of his fool?
Aye, madam.
By day and night he wrongs me. Every hour he flashes into one gross crime or other that sets us all at odds. I'll not endure it. His nights grow riotous, and himself upbraids us on every trifle. When he returns from hunting, I will not speak with him. Say, I am sick. Slack your former services. Of it, I'll answer.
He's coming, madam. I hear him.
If he distasted, let him to my sister, whose mind and mine I know in that are one. Remember what I tell you.
Well, madam.
And let his knights have colder looks among you, too. What grows of it, no matter. Advise your fellow so. I'll write straight to my sister to hold my very course. Hmm. Prepare for dinner.
If but as well I other disguise borrow, that can my looks diffuse, my good intent may carry through itself to that full issue for which I raised my likeness. Now, banished Kent, if thou canst serve where thou dost stand condemned, so may it come, thy master, whom thou lovest, shall find thee full of labors.
And,
Let me not stay a jot for dinner. Go, get it ready. Now, how now? What art thou?
A man, sir.
Now, but what dost thou profess? What wouldst thou with us?
I do profess to be no less than I seem. To serve him truly that will put me in trust, to love him that is honest, to converse with him that is wise and says little, to fear judgment, to fight when I cannot choose, and to eat no fish.
But what art thou?
A very honest-hearted fellow, and as poor as the king.
Well, if thou be as poor for a subject as he is for a king, thou art poor enough. But what wouldst thou?
Service.
Who wouldst thou serve?
You.
Dost thou know me, fellow?
No, sir. But you have that in your countenance which I would fain call master.
What's that?
Authority.
Ah. Well, what services canst thou do?
I can keep honest counsel. Ride, run, mar a curious tale in telling it, and deliver a plain message bluntly. That which ordinary men are fit for, I am qualified in, and the best of me is diligence.
And how old are you, Diligence?
Not so young, sir, to love a woman for singing, nor too old to dote on her for anything. I have years on my back, 48.
So, follow me, thou shalt serve me. Now, if I like thee no better after dinner, I will not part with thee yet. Oh, dinner, hold dinner.
Dinner, hold dinner.
Believe, my fool. Oh, you, Sirda, you, where's my daughter?
So please you.
What says the fellow there? Call the clock pole back. But where's my fool? Ho! I think the world's asleep. Now, how now? Where's that mongrel?
He says, my lord, your daughter is not well.
Why came not the slave back to me when I called him?
Sir, he answered me in the roundest manner. He would not.
He would not.
My lord, I know not what the matter is, but there's a great abatement of kindness appears in the general dependence. and also in your daughter.
Ah! Sayest thou so?
I beseech you, pardon me, my lord.
But I have perceived a most faint neglect of late. I'll look further into that. But where's my fool? I've not seen him this 2 days.
Since my young lady's going into France, the fool hath much pined away.
No more of that. I have noted it well. Go you and tell my daughter I would speak with her. Call hither, my fool! Oh, you, sir. You. Come you hither, sir. Who am I, sir?
My lady's father.
My lady's father, my lord's knave, you horse and dog! You slave, you cur!
I am none of these, my lord. I beseech your pardon.
Do you bandy looks with me, you rascal?
Ha! I will not be struck in my life!
Nor tripped neither! You base football player!
I thank thee, fellow, thou serv'st me and I'll love thee. Now, my friendly knave, here's earnest of thy service.
Let me hire him, too. Here's my coxcomb.
Now, my pretty knave, how dost thou, boy?
Sirrah, you were best take my coxcomb.
Why, fool?
Why, for taking one's part that's out of favor. Thou'lt catch cold shortly. There, take my coxcomb. Why, this fellow has banished 2 on's daughters and did the 3rd a blessing against his will. If thou follow him, thou must needs wear my coxcomb. How now, nuncle? Would I had 2 coxcombs and 2 daughters!
Why, my boy?
If I gave them all my living, I'd keep my coxcombs for myself. There's mine. Beg another of thy daughters.
Now take heed, sirrah, the whip.
Ooh, truth's a dog must to kennel. He must be whipped out when Lady the Brach may stand by the fire and stink. Sirrah, I'll teach thee a speech.
Do, lad, do.
Have more than thou showest. Speak less than thou knowest. Lend less than thou owest. Ride more than thou goest. Set less than thou trowest. Learn more than thou trowest. Leave thy drink and thy whore and keep in a door, and thou shalt have more than 2/10 to a score.
This is nothing, fool.
Then 'tis like the breath of an unfeed lawyer. You gave me nothing for it. Can you make no use of nothing, nuncle?
Why, no, lad. Nothing can be made out of nothing.
Prithee, tell him so much the rent of his land comes to. He'll not believe a fool.
A bitter fool.
Dost thou know the difference, my boy, between a bitter fool and a sweet fool?
No, lad, teach me.
That lord that counseled thee to give away thy land, come, place him here by me. What do thou for him stand, eh? The sweet
and bitter fool will presently appear. The one in motley here, the other found out there.
Dost thou call me fool, boy?
All thy other titles thou hast given away. That thou wast born with.
This is not altogether fool, my lord.
Me an egg, nuncle, and I'll give thee 2 crowns.
Now what 2 crowns shall they be, boy?
Why, after I have cut the egg in the middle and eat up the meat, the 2 crowns of the egg. Thou clovest thy crown in the middle and gavest away both parts. Thou hadst little wit in thy bald crown when thou gavest thy golden one away. If I speak like myself in this, let him be whipped
that first finds it so. Fools had ne'er less wit in a year, for wise men are grown so foppish, they know not how their wits to wear. Their manners are so apish.
When wast thou wont to be so full of song, sirrah?
I have used it, nuncle, ever since thou madest thy daughters thy mothers. For when thou gavest them the rod and putst down thine own breeches. What? Prithee, nuncle, keep a schoolmaster that can teach thy fool to lie. I would fain learn to lie.
And thou liest, sirrah, will have thee whipped.
I marvel what kin thou and thy daughters are. They'll have me whipped for speaking true. Thou'lt have me whipped for lying. And sometimes I am whipped for holding my peace. I had rather be any kind of thing than a fool. And yet, I would not be thee, nuncle. I am better than thou art now. I am a fool. Thou art nothing. Thou hast pared thy wit to both sides and left nothing in the middle. Here comes one of the pairings.
Are you our daughter?
Come, sir. I would you would make use of that good wisdom whereof I know you are fraught, and put aside these dispositions that of late transform you from what you rightly are.
May not an ass know when the cart draws the horse?
Doth
jug, I love thee.
Any here know me? Now this is not Lear. Does Lear walk thus? Speak thus? Where are his eyes? Now, who is it that can tell me who I am?
Lear's shadow.
I would learn that, boy. For by the marks of sovereignty, knowledge, and reason, I should be false persuaded I had daughters.
Which they will make an obedient father.
Your name, fair gentlewoman?
I do beseech you to understand my purposes aright. As you are old and reverend, should be wise. Here, do you keep 100 knights and squires, men so disordered, so debauched, and bold that this, our court, infected with their manners, shows like a riotous inn. Gluttony and lust make it more like a tavern, or a brothel than a graced palace.
No!
The shame itself doth speak for instant remedy. Be then desired by her, that else will take the thing she begs, a little to disquantity your train, and the remainder that shall still depend to be such men as may be sort your age, and know themselves, and you.
Oh, darkness and devils! Saddled my horses, called my train together. Degenerate bastard, but I'll not trouble thee, yet have I left a daughter.
You strike my people, and your disordered rabble make servants out you.
Is this your will? Speak, sir! I'll prepare my horses. Ingratitude, thou marble-hearted fiend, more hideous when thou showest thee in a child than the sea monster.
Pray, sir, have patience.
Detested kite, thou liest! My train are men of choice and rarest parts that all particulars of duty know, and in the most exact regard support the worships of their names. Oh, most small fault, how ugly didst thou in Cordelia show? Oh, Lear, 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 beat at this gate which let thy folly in and thy dear judgment out. Oh, go, go!
My lord, I am guiltless as I am ignorant of what hath moved you.
That may be so, my lord. Here, nature, here. Dear goddess, here! Suspend thy purpose if thou didst intend to make this creature fruitful. Into her womb convey sterility. Dry up in her the organs of increase, and from her derogate body never spring a babe to honor her. But if she must teem, create her child of spleen, that it may live and be athwart this nature torment to her. Let it stamp wrinkles in her brow of youth, with cadent tears, fret channels in her cheeks, turn all her mother's pains and benefits to laughter and contempt, that she may feel how sharper than a serpent's tooth it is to have a thankless child. Away!
Now, gods that we adore, whereof comes this?
Never afflict yourself to know the cause, but let his disposition have that scope that old age gives it!
What? 50 of my followers at a clap!
What's the matter, sir?
Within a fortnight! I'll tell thee what's the matter. I am ashamed that she has power to shake my manhood thus. That these hot tears which break from me perforce should make thee worth them. Oh, fond eyes, beweep this cause again, I'll pluck out! Oh, yea, is it come to this? Well, let it be so, yet have I another daughter who I am sure is kind and comfortable. When she shall hear this of thee, with her nails she'll flay that wolfish visage. Thou shalt find I have resumed the shape which thou dost think I have cast off forever. Thou shalt! I warrant thee!
Do you mark that, my lord?
I cannot be so partial, Goneril, to the great love I bear you.
I pray you content. What, Oswald? Ho, you, sir, more knave than fool, after your master.
Uncle Lear, tarry, and take the fool with thee.
This man hath had good counsel 100 nights. Oswald, I say! What, ho, Oswald, have you writ that letter to my sister?
Aye, madam.
Away to horse. Inform her full of my particular fear. And thereto add such reasons of your own as may compact it more. Get you gone, and hasten your return.
Goneril.
No.
We...
No, no, my lord. This milky gentleness and course of yours, you are much more attasked for want of wisdom than praised for harmful mildness.
How far your eyes can pierce, I cannot tell. Striving to better off we mar what's well.
Nay, nay.
Well. Well. The event.
Go you before to Cornwall with these letters. Inform my daughter Regan. If your diligence be not speedy, I shall be there afore you.
I will not sleep, my lord, till I have delivered your letters.
If a man's brains were in teals, were it not in danger of chilblains?
Aye, my boy.
Then I prithee, be merry, huh? Thy wit shall ne'er go slipshod.
Ha, ha, ha.
Shall see. Thy other daughter will use thee kindly, though she's as like this as a crab's to an apple, yet I can tell what I can tell.
Now what canst tell, my boy?
She'll taste as like this as a crab does to a crab. Thou canst! one's nose stands in the Milord's face?
No.
Why, to keep one's eyes on either side's nose, that what a man cannot smell out, he may spy into.
I did her wrong.
Thou canst tell how an oyster makes its shell?
No.
Nor I neither. But I can tell why a snail has a house.
Oh, why?
Why, to put head in, not to give it away to his daughters and leave his horns without a case.
Though I shall forget my nature, so kind a father, be my horses ready.
Thy asses are gone about him. The reason why the seven stars are no more than seven is a pretty reason.
Because they are not eight.
Yes, indeed. Thou wouldst make a good fool.
Oh, to take it again, perforce! Oh, monster ingratitude!
If thou wert my fool, Nuncle, I'd have thee beaten for
being old
before thy time.
How's that?
Thou shouldst not have been old till thou hadst been wise.
Oh, let me not be mad. Not mad, sweet heaven. To keep me in temper, I would not be mad. Ah, now, are my horses ready?
Ready, my lord?
Come.
Cornwall be here tonight? The better. Best! This weaves itself perforce into my business. Briefness and fortune work. Brother, a word! Descend, brother, I say! My father watches. Oh, sir, fly this place. Intelligence is given where you are hid. I hear my father coming. Pardon me, in cunning I must draw my sword upon you. Draw, seem to defend yourself. Now, quit you well. Yield. Come before my father! Light, how, here! Fly, brother. Torches, torches! So farewell! Some blood drawn on me would beget opinion of my more fierce endeavor. I've seen drunkards do more than this in sport. Oh, father! Father, stop, stop! No help!
No! Edmund! Where's the villain?
Here stood he in the dark, his sharp sword out, mumbling of wicked charms.
But where is he?
Look, sir, I bleed.
Where is the villain, Edmund?
Fled this way, sir, when by no means he could...
Pursue him, I'll go after! By no means what?
Persuade me to the murder of your lordship. Seeing how loathly opposite I stood to his unnatural purpose, in fell motion with his prepared sword he lanced mine arm. But when he saw my best alarum spirits, full suddenly he fled.
Oh, let him fly far. Not in this land shall he remain uncaught. That he which finds him shall deserve our thanks, bringing the murderous coward to the stake. He that conceals him, death.
When I dissuaded him from his intent and found him pight to do it, I threatened to discover him. He replied, thou unpossessing bastard, dost thou think if I would stand against thee that any trust, virtue, or worth in thee make thy words faith?
Oh, strange and fastened villain! Would he deny his letter, said he? Hark! Cornwall's trumpets! I know not why he comes. All ports I'll bar! The villain shall not scape! And of my land, loyal and natural boy, I'll work the means to make thee capable.
How now, my noble friend? Since I came hither, which I can call but now, I've heard strange news.
If it be true, all vengeance comes too short, which can pursue the offender. How dost, my lord?
Oh, madam, my old heart is cracked! It's cracked!
What? Did my father's godson seek your life? He whom my father named your Edgar?
Oh, lady, lady, shame would have it hid.
Was he not companioned with riotous knights that tend upon my father?
Oh, 'tis too bad, too bad.
Yes, madam, he was of that consort.
No marvel, then, though he be ill affected. 'Tis they have put him on the old man's death to have the expense and waste of his revenues. I have this present evening been well informed of them, and with such cautions that if they come to sojourn at my house, I'll not be there.
Nor I, assure thee, Regan. Edmund, I've heard that you have shown your father a childlike office.
'Twas my duty, sir.
He did expose his practice and receive this hurt you see, striving to apprehend him.
Is he pursued?
Aye, my good lord.
If he be taken, he shall no longer be feared of doing harm. For you, Edmund, whose virtue and obedience doth this instant so much commend itself, you shall be ours. Natures of such deep trust, we shall much need.
I shall serve you, sir.
For him, I thank your grace.
You know not why we came to visit you.
Thus out of season threading, dark-eyed knight, occasions, noble Gloucester, of some poise wherein we might have use of your advice. My father, he hath writ, so hath my sister, of differences, which we best thought it fit to answer away from home. Our good old friend, lay comfort to your bosom and bestow your needful counsel on our business, which craves the instant use.
I serve you, madam. Your graces are right welcome.
Good dawning to thee, friend. Art of this house.
Aye.
Where may we set our horses?
In the mire.
Prithee, if thou lovest me, tell me.
I love thee not.
Why, then I care not for thee.
Fellow, I would make thee care for me.
Ah, why dost thou use me thus? I know thee not.
Fellow, I know thee.
Oh, and what dost thou know me for?
A knave, a rascal, an eater of broken meats, a base, proud, shallow, beggarly, three-suited, 100-pound, filthy, worsted stocking knave, a lily-livered, action-taking knave, a whoreson, super-serviceable, finical rogue, and art nothing but the composition of a knave, coward, beggar, pander, and son and heir of a mongrel bitch, one whom I will beat into clamorous whining if thou deniest the least syllable of thy addition.
Why, what a monstrous fellow thou art to rail on one that is neither known of thee nor knows thee.
What a brazen-faced varlet art thou to deny thou knowest me. Is it not 2 days since I tripped up thy heels and beat thee before the king? Draw, you rogue. Draw, you whoreson, cullionly, barbermonger, draw!
Oh, wait, I have nothing to do with thee!
Draw, you rascal! You come with letters against the king! Draw, rogue! Or I'll so carbonado your shank! Draw, you rascal! Come your ways!
Help! Help! Murder! Murder!
Strike, rogue! Strike! Strike!
Help!
Help! Stand, rogue, stand! You meat slave, strike!
Help! Help! Murder! Murder!
His arms! What's the matter?
Keep peace upon your lives! He dies that strikes again! What is the matter?
The messenger is from our sister and the king.
What is the difference between you speak?
This ancient ruffian, sir, whose life I spare, that suit of his gray beard.
Oh, thou whoreson Zed! Thou unnecessary letter! My lord, if you will give me leave, I will tread this unbolted villain into the mortar. Spare my gray beard, you wagtail!
Peace, Sarah! You beastly knave, know you no reverence?
Aye, sir, but anger hath a privilege.
Why art thou angry?
Such a slave should wear a weapon that wears no honor. No contraries hold more antipathy than I and such a knave.
Why dost thou call him a knave? What's his offense?
His countenance likes me not.
Ah, no more perchance does mine, nor his nor hers.
Sir, 'tis my occupation to be plain. I have seen better faces in my time than stands on any shoulder that I see before me this instant.
This is a fellow who, having been praised for bluntness, doth affect a saucy disposition.
Sir, I know I am no flatterer, but he that beguiled you in a plain accent is a plain knave.
What offense did you give him?
I never gave him any!
Oh, I'll get...
It pleased the king, his master, very late to strike at me. And then he, compact, insulted and tripped me from behind. And then such a man in flesh drill on me here again.
A plague upon your epileptic visage!
Fetch forth the stocks, you stubborn ancient knave, you reverend braggart, we'll teach you.
Sir, I am too old to learn. Call not your stocks for me, I serve the king. On whose employment I was sent to you. You shall do small respect, show too bold malice against his grace and person, my master, stalking his messenger.
Fetch forth the stocks! As I have life and honor, there shall he sit till noon.
Till noon, till night, my lord, and all night too.
Madam, were I your father's dog, you should not use me so.
Sir, being his knave, I will.
This is a fellow of the selfsame color our sister told us of. Bring in the stocks!
Let me beseech your grace not to do so. The good king, his master, must take it ill that he's so slightly valued in his messenger and punished as most common trespassers should have him thus restrained.
I'll answer that.
My sister will receive it much more worse to have her gentleman abused, assaulted for following her affairs. Put in his leg. Come, my good lord, away.
I am sorry for thee, friend. 'Tis the Duke's pleasure, whose disposition all the world well knows will not be rubbed nor stopped. I'll entreat for thee.
Pray, sir, do not. I have watched and traveled hard. Sometime I'll sleep out, the rest I'll whistle. God give you good morrow.
The Duke's to blame in this, 'twill be ill taken.
Approach, thou beacon, to this underglobe, that by thy comfortable beams I might peruse this letter. I know 'tis from Cordelia, who most fortunately hath been informed of my obscured course. Take vantage, heavy eyes, not to behold this shameful lodging. Fortune, good night! Smile once again! Turn thy wheel!
I heard myself proclaimed, and by the happy hollow of a tree escaped the hunt. No port is free, no place that guard and most unusual vigilance does not attend my taking. Whiles I may scape, I will preserve myself, and am bethought to take the basest, most poorest shape that ever penury and contempt of man brought near to beast. My face I'll grime with filth, blanket my loins, elf all my hairs in knots, and with presented nakedness outface the winds and persecutions of the sky. The country gives me proof and precedent of bedlam beggars who with roaring voices strike in their numbed and mortified bare arms, pins, wooden pricks, nails, sprigs of rosemary, and with this horrible object from low farms, poor pelting villages, sheepcotes and mills, sometimes with lunatic bands, sometimes with prayers, enforce their charity. Poor Turley, God. Poor Tom. That's something yet. Edgar, I nothing am.
"'Tis strange that they should so depart from home and not send back my messenger.
Hail to thee, noble master!
Makes thou this shame thy pastime?
No, my lord.
He wears cruel garters.
What's he that hath thy place so much mistook to set thee here?
It is both he and she, your son and daughter.
Oh, no.
Yes.
No, I say.
I say yea.
No, no, they would not.
Yes, they have.
By Jupiter, I swear no.
By Juno, I swear I.
But they durst not do it. They could not, would not do it. Why, 'tis worse than murder to do upon respect such violent outrage. Resolve me with all modest haste which way thou mightst deserve, or they impose this usage on thee coming from us.
Sir, when at their home I did your highness's letters commend to them, ere I was risen, came there a reeking post, stewed in his haste, half breathless, panting forth from Goneril his mistress's salutations, delivered letters, spite of intermission, which presently they read, and on the contents they summoned up their meanie, straight took horse, commanded me to follow and attend the leisure of their answer, gave me cold looks, and seeing the other messenger, whose welcome I perceived, had poisoned mine, being the very fellow that of late displayed so saucily against your highness, I, having more man than wit, drew. He raised the house with cold and coward cries. Your son and daughter found this trespass to be worth the shame which here it suffers.
Fathers that wear rags do make their children blind, but fathers that bear bags will see their children kind. Fortune, that errant whore, ne'er turns the key to the poor.
Oh, how this mother swells up towards my heart. Oh, hysterica passio, down thou climbing sorrow. Thy elements below. Where is this daughter?
With the Earl, sir, here within.
Now follow me not. Stay here.
Made you no more offense but what you speak of?
No. How comes it the king travels with so small a train?
And thou hadst been set in the stocks for that question. Thou hadst well deserved it.
Why, fool?
Let go thy hold when a great wheel runs down a hill, lest it break thy neck with following it. But the great one that goes up the hill, let him draw thee after. When a wise man gives thee better counsel, give me mine again.
Where learned you this, fool?
Not in the stocks, fool.
Deny to speak with me? They are sick, they are weary, they have traveled all the night. Near fetches. Nay, fetch me a better answer.
My dear lord, you know the fiery quality of the duke, how unremovable and fixed he is.
Oh, vengeance, plagues, death, confusion, fiery, what quality? My Gloucester, Gloucester. I'd speak with the Duke of Cornwall and his wife.
Well, my good lord, I have informed them so.
Informed them? Dost thou understand me, man?
Aye, my good lord.
The king would speak with Cornwall. The dear father would with his daughter speak. Command services, are they informed of this? Oh, my breath and blood. Fiery, fiery, Duke. Well, tell the hot Duke that Lear... No, not yet. Maybe he is not well. Infirmity doth still neglect all cause. We are not then ourselves. I will forbear. Oh, but death on my state, wherefore should he sit here? Now this act persuades me that this remotion of the Duke and her is practice only. Give me my servant forth. Go tell the Duke and his wife I would speak with them. Thou presently bid them come forth and hear me, or at their chamber door I'll beat the drum till it cry sleep to death.
I have all well betwixt you.
Oh me, my heart, my rising heart, but down.
Cry to it, Nuncle.
Good morrow to you both.
Hail to your grace.
I am glad to see your highness.
Regan, I think you are, if thou shouldst not be glad. I would divorce me from thy mother's tomb. Oh, beloved Regan, thy sister's not. Oh, Regan, she hath tied sharp-toothed unkindness like a vulture here. I could scarce speak to thee. Thou'dst not believe with how depraved a quality. Oh, Regan.
I pray you, sir, take patience. I believe you less know how to value her desert than she to scant her duty.
Say, how is this?
I cannot think my sister in the least would fail her obligation. If, sir, perchance she have restrained the riots of your followers, 'tis on such ground, and to such wholesome end as clears her from all blame.
My curse is on her!
Oh, sir, you are old. Nature and you stand on the very verge of your confines. You should be ruled and led by some discretion which discerns yourself better than your state. Therefore, I pray you that to my sister you do make return. Say you have wronged her, sir.
Ask her forgiveness? Dear daughter, I confess that I am old. Age is unnecessary. On my knees I beg that thou vouchsafe me clothing, bed, and food.
Good sir, no more. These are unsightly tricks. Return you to my sister.
No, never, Regan. She hath abated me of half my train, looked black upon me, struck me with her tongue most serpent-like upon the very heart. Oh, all the stored vengeances of heaven light on her ingrateful top. Strike her young bones, you
take. Bless God, so will you wish on me when the rash mood is on.
Oh, no, no, Regan, thou shalt never have my curse. Thy tender-hefted nature will not give thee aught to harshness. Her eyes are fierce, but thine do comfort and not burn. 'Tis not in thee to grudge my pleasures, to cut off my train, to bandy hasty words. Thou better knowest the offices of nature, bonds of childhood, effects of courtesy, the dues of gratitude. Why, thy half of the kingdom thou hast not forgot, wherein I thee endowed.
Good sir, to the purpose.
Who put my man in the stocks? Who stalked my servant? Regan, I have good hope thou didst not know, aunt. Oh, who comes here? Oh, you heavens, if you do love old men, if you yourselves are old, make it your cause, send down to take my part. Oh, Goneril, art not ashamed to look upon this beard? What, Regan? Wilt thou take her by the hand?
Why not by the hand, sir? How have I offended?
Oh, signs, you are too tough! Will you yet hold? How came my man in the stock?
I set him there, my lord. You and his disorders deserved far worse in payment.
Did you?
I pray you, father, being weak seems so. If to the expiration of your month you will return and sojourn with my sister, dismissing half your train, come then to me, for I am now from home and out of that provision which shall be needful for your entertainment.
Return to her? And 50 men dismissed? No, Rather, I abjure all roofs and choose to wage against the enmity of the air, to be a comrade to the wolf and the owl. Oh, return with her.
At your choice, sir.
But I prithee, daughter, do not make me mad. I will trouble you no more. Farewell, my child. We'll no more meet, no more see one another. But yet you are my flesh, my blood, my daughter. Or a disease that's in my flesh, which I must needs call mine. Which I must needs call mine, mine. But I'll not chide thee. I can be patient. I can stay with Regan. I and my 100 knights.
Not altogether so. I looked not for you, nor am provided for your fit welcome. She knows what she does.
Is this well spoken?
I dare avouch it, sir. What, 50 followers? Is it not well? What need you of more?
Why might not you, my lord, receive attendance from those that she calls servants, or from mine?
Why not, my lord? Should you come with me, I entreat you to bring but 5 and 20. To no more will I give place nor notice.
But I gave you all!
And in good time you gave it.
Made you my guardians, my depositaries. What? Must I come to thee with 5 and 20, Regan?
And
said you so.
Speak it again, my lord, no more with me.
I'll go with thee, Goneril. Thy 50 yet doth double. 5 and 20, and thou art twice her love.
Hear me, my lord. What need you, 5 and 20? 10 or 5?
What need one?
Oh, reason not the need. Oh, basest beggars, ye heavens, give me that patience I need. You see me here, you gods, a poor old man, as full of grief as age, wretched in both. If it be you that stir these daughters' hearts against their father, fool me not so much to bear it tamely. Touch me with noble anger, and let not women's weapons' water drop stain these man's cheeks. No, you unnatural hags! I will have such revenges on you both that all the world shall. I will do such things. What they are yet I know not, but they shall be the terrors of the earth. You think I'll weep? No, I'll not weep. I have full cause of weeping. But this heart shall break into 100,000 flaws, or ere I'll weep. Oh, fool, fool, oh, fool, oh, fool, I shall go mad. Oh, fool, I shall go mad, I shall go mad. Oh, fool, I shall go mad.
Let's withdraw. It will be a storm.
The house is little. The old man and his people could not be well bestowed.
'Tis his own blame. Put himself from rest, and must needs taste his folly.
For his particular, I'll receive him gladly, but not one follower.
So am I purposed. Where is my lord of Gloucester?
Followed the old man forth. He is returned.
The king is in high rage.
Whither is he going?
He calls the horse, but will I know not whither.
It's best you give him way. He leads himself.
My lord, entreat him by no means to stay.
Alack, the night comes on, and the bleak winds do sorely ruffle. For many miles about, there's scarce a bush.
Sir, To willful men, the injuries that they themselves procure must be their schoolmasters. Shut up your doors.
Shut up your doors! My lord, it's a wild night. My Regan counsels well. Come out of the storm!
You crack your cheeks. Rage. Blow, you cataracts and hurricanoes. Spawn till you have benched our steeples. Round the clocks. Sulfurous and thought executing fires. Vaunt couriers of oak cleaving thunderbolts. Singe my white head. Thou all shaking thunder strike, fly perfect rotundity of the world. Crack nature's molds, how germs spill it once that making grateful man.
Uncle, court holy water in a dry house is better than this rainwater out a door. Good uncle, in and ask thy daughter's blessing. Here's a night pities neither wise man nor
rumble my belly door, spit fire, spout rain, nor rain, wind, thunder, fire are my daughters. I tax you not, you elements, with unkindness. I never gave you kingdom, called you children. You owe me no subscription, and then let fall your horrible pleasure. Here I stand, your slave, poor, infirm, weak, despised old man. But yet I call you servile ministers, who did with two pernicious daughters join your high-engendered battles against a head so old, white as this. Oh, 'tis foul!
Oh, he that has a house to put his head in, good head piece.
No, I will be the pattern of all patience. I will say nothing.
Who's there?
Mary, here's grace and a cod piece. That's a wise man and a fool.
Alas, sir, are you here? Things that love night love not such nights as these. Since I was man, such sheets of fire, such bursts of horrid thunder, such roaring groans of wind and rain, I never remember to have heard.
But let the great gods that keep this dreadful power o'er our heads find out their enemies now. I am a man more sinned against than sinning.
Alack, sir, bareheaded! Gracious, my lord, hard by here is a hovel. Some friendship will lend you against the tempest.
My wits begin to turn. How now, my boy? How dost thou whine? Art cold? Cold myself. Where is this straw, fellow? Poor knave and fool, but I have one part in my heart that's sorry yet with me. Tis true, boy. Come, bring us to this hovel.
He that has in a little tiny wind, hey ho, the wind and the rain must make content with his fortune's fit. For the rain it raineth every day.
Alack, alack, Edmund, I like not this unnatural dealing. When I desire their leave, that I might pity him, they took from me the use of mine own house.
charged me, on pain of their perpetual displeasure, neither to speak of him, entreat for him, nor any way sustain him.
Most savage and unnatural.
Oh, go to. Say you nothing. There is a division betwixt the Dukes Albany and Cornwall, and a worse matter than that. I have received a letter this night. 'Tis dangerous to be spoken. These injuries the king now bears will be revenged home. There's part of a power already landed. We must incline to the king. I will seek him and privily relieve him. Go you and maintain talk with the Duke, that my charity be not of him perceived. If he ask for me, I am ill and gone to bed, though I die for it, as no less is threatened me. The king, my old master, must be relieved. There is some strange thing toward Edmund. Pray you, be careful.
This courtesy forbid thee shall the Duke instantly know, and of this letter too. This seems a fair deserving, and must draw me that which my father loses, no less than all. The younger rises when the old doth fall.
Here it is, my lord! Could my lord enter here? The tyranny of the open night is too rough for nature to endure!
My lord, let me alone!
Could my lord enter here?
Will break my heart.
I had rather break my own! Could my lord enter?
The tempest in my mind doth from my senses take all feeling else save what beats there! Filial ingratitude, is it not as if this mouth should tear this hand for lifting food to it? But I will punish home. For on, I will endure. And such a night as this to shut me out. The whole Regan, Goneril, you old kind father whose frank heart gave all. No, that way madness lies. Let me shun that. No more of that.
Good, my lord, enter here.
This tempest in my mind doth from my senses take all feeling else save what beats there. But how, prithee, get in thyself. Nay, lad, get thee in. In, boy. Go first. I'll pray. Then I'll sleep. Poor naked wretches, wheresoe'er ye are, that bide the pelting of this pitiless storm, how shall your houseless heads, your unfed sides, your holden window wagons defend you from seasons such as these? Oh, I have ta'en too little care of this.
Fathom it out! Fathom it out! Poor Tom!
Not in here, Nungo! Here's a spirit! Help me! Help
Give me!
Give
me thy hand! Who's there?
Spirit! A spirit! He says his name's Poor Tom!
What art thou that dost grumble in the straw? Come forth!
Away! The foul fiend follows me! Our hawthorn blows the cold wind. I get thee to thy cold bed and warm thee.
Didst thou give all to thy daughters? And art thou come to this?
Now who gives anything to poor Tom, whom the foul fiend hath led through fire and through flame, through ford and whirlpool, that hath laid knives under my pillow and set rat's bane by his porridge? So through the hawthorn blows the cold wind. Bless thy five wits.
Has his daughters brought him to this pass? Didst thou give him all? Couldst thou save nothing?
Nay, he reserved a blanket, else we had been all shamed.
Now let me. Oh, the start, curses and vengeances have been light on thy ungrateful daughters!
He hath no daughters, sir!
Of death, traitor! Nothing could have subdued nature to such a lowness but his unkind daughters.
Kill, 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 halloo, halloo, halloo.
This cold night will turn us all to fools and madmen.
But what hast thou been?
A serving man, proud of heart and mind, that curled my hair, wore gloves in my cap, and served the lust of my mistress' heart, and did the deed of darkness with her. One that swore as many oaths as I spake words, and broke them in the sweet face of heaven. That slept in the contriving of lust, and waked to do it. Wine loved I dearly, dice dearly, and in women out-paramoured the Turk.
As through the hawthorn blows the cold wind, says some anonani.
Why, thou wert better in thy grave than to answer with thy uncovered body this extremity of the skies. Now is man no more than this? Thou art the thing itself. Unaccommodated man is no more but such a poor bare-forked animal as thou art. Off, you lendings, come! Unbutton here!
Prithee, Nuncle, be contented! Oh. It's a naughty night you swim in! Look, here comes a walking fire!
This is the foul fiend, Liberty Gibbet! He hurts the poor creatures of the earth! Aright thee, witch! Aright thee!
How fares your grace?
No, what's he?
Who's there? What is you see?
What are you there? Your name?
The poor Tom that eats the swimming frog, the toad, the tadpole, the walnut in the water, and sometimes in the fury of his heart, when the foul fiend rages, eats cow dung for salads.
What? Have your grace no better company? Go in with me. My duty cannot suffer to obey in all your daughter's hard commands, though their injunction be to bar my doors and let this tyrannous knight lay hold upon you, yet have I ventured to come seek you out and bring you where both fire and food is ready.
Now first let me talk with this philosopher. What is the cause of thunder?
Good my lord, take his offer. Go into the house.
I will talk a word with this same learned scholar. Now, what is thy study?
Oh, to prevent the fiend and to kill vermin.
No, let me ask you one word in private.
Good my lord, importune him once more. His wits begin to unsettle.
Canst thou blame him? His daughters seek his death. That good Kent, he said it would be thus. Poor banished man. Thou sayest the king grows mad. I'll tell thee, friend, I am almost mad myself. I had a son, now outlawed from my blood. He sought my life. But lately, very late, I loved him, friend. No father, his son, dearer. True to tell thee, the grief hath traced my wits. What a night's this! I do beseech your grace!
Oh, cry you mercy, sir! Noble philosopher,
your company! Oh, fellow there! Into the hovel!
Get thee warm! Let's in all! With
this
him!
This way, my lord! With him. This way!
I will keep still with my philosopher!
Come, my lord, soothe him! Let him take the fellow!
Take him, you on!
Come, sirrah, go along with us!
Oh, come, good Athenian!
Oh,
come, good Athenian.
I smell the blood of a British man.
Come, good Athenian.
Fire, and fire.
No words.
I smell the blood.
No words.
Of a British man.
Hush.
Fire, and fire. I smell.
I will have my revenge ere I depart his house.
This is the letter he spoke of, which approves him an intelligent party to the advantages of France. Oh, heavens. That this treason were not, or not I, the detector.
Go with me to the Duchess.
If the matter of this paper be certain, you have mighty business in hand.
True or false, it hath made thee Earl of Gloucester. Seek out where thy father is, that he may be ready for our apprehension.
If I find him comforting the king, it will stuff his suspicion more fully. I will persevere in my course of loyalty, though the conflict be sore between that and my blood.
We will lay trust upon you, and you shall find a dearer father in our love.
He is better than the open air! Take it, thankfully. I will piece out the comfort with what addition I can. I will not be long from you.
All the power of his wits have given way to his impatience. The gods reward your kindness.
Prithee, Nuncle, tell me whether a madman be a gentleman or a yeoman.
A king. A king.
No, he's a madman that has a gentleman to his son. For he's a mad yeoman that sees his son a gentleman before him.
Valfine bites my back.
Never trust in the tameness of a wolf, a boy's love, or a whore's oath.
It shall be done. I will arraign them straight. Come sit you here, most learned justicer. Thou, sage sir, sit here. Oh, you she-foxes, now!
See where she stands and stares!
How do you, sir? Will you lie down and rest?
No, I'll see their trial first. Bring in the evidence. Thou, robed man of justice, take thy place. Thou, his yoke-fellow in equity, bench by his side. And you are of the commission. Sit you too.
Let us deal justly. Purr, the cat is gray.
Arraign her first. 'Tis Goneril, I here take my oath before this honorable assembly, did kick the king, her poor father.
Prithee, mistress, come hither. Is your name Goneril?
Ah, she cannot deny it.
Cry you mercy, I took you for a joint stool.
Oh, and there's Regan. Whose warped looks proclaim what store her heart is set on. Stop her! Stop her! Arms! Arms! Sword! Fire! Corruption in the place! False justicer! Why is the letter escape?
Bless thy five wits!
Oh, pity! Where is thy patience now that thou so oft have boasted to retain?
My tears begin to take his part so much they'll mar my counterfeiting.
The little dogs. See, they bark at me.
Oh, Tom will throw his head at them. Avaunt, you curs!
Is there any cause in nature that makes these hard hearts?
No. Sir, will you lie down and rest?
Make no noise. Make no noise. Draw the curtains. So, we'll go to supper in the morning. So.
And I'll go to bed at noon.
So.
Come hither, fellow! Where is the king, my master?
Here, but trouble him not, his wits are gone.
Good friend, I pray thee, take him in thy arms. I have o'erheard a plot of death upon him. There is a litter ready, lay him in it, and drive towards Dover, where thou shalt meet both welcome and protection. Take up thy master, if thou shouldst dally half an hour, his life and thine, and all that offer to defend him, stand in assured loss. Take up, and follow me, that will to some provision give thee quick conduct.
Oh, oppressed night sleeps. This rest else may have balmed thy broken senses. Come along. Help to bear your master. Thou must not stay behind.
Come away.
when we, our betters, see bearing our woes, we scarcely think our miseries our foes. How light and portable my pain seems now, when that which makes me bend makes the king bow. Tom, away!
Save the king!
Post speedily to my lord your husband.
Give him this letter. The armies of France have landed.
Seek out the traitor Gloucester.
Hang him instantly. Pluck out his eyes.
Leave him to my displeasure. Edmund, keep you our sister company. The revenges we are bound to take upon your traitorous father are not fit for your beholding. Advise Albany, where you are going, to a most speedy preparation. Our posts shall be swift and intelligent betwixt us. Farewell, sister. Farewell, my lord of Gloucester. Where is the king?
My lord of Gloucester hath conveyed him hence, who with some other of the lord's dependents are gone with him toward Dover, where they boast to have well-armed friends.
Go fetch thy mistress' horses.
Farewell, sweet lord. And sister?
Edmund, farewell. Who's there, the traitor?
Ingrateful fox, 'tis he.
Bind fast his corky arms.
What means your graces? Good my friends, consider. You are my guests. Do me no foul play, friend.
Bind him, I say.
Hard. Hard, you filthy traitor.
Unmerciful lady, as you are, I am none.
To this stone bind him. Villain, thou shalt find...
By the kind gods, 'tis most ignobly done to pluck me by the beard!
So white and such a traitor!
Naughty lady, I am your host, what will you do?
Come, sir, what letters had you late from France?
Be simple, answerer, for we know the truth.
And what confederacy have you with the traitors late footed in the kingdom?
To whose hands have you sent the lunatic king? Speak!
I have a letter guessingly set down, which came from one that's of a neutral heart, and not from one opposed.
Cunning.
And false.
Where hast thou sent the king?
To Dover!
Wherefore to Dover? Wast thou not charged at peril?
Wherefore to Dover? Let him first answer that.
I am tied to the stake, and I must stand the course.
Wherefore to Dover, sir?
Because I would not see thy cruel nails pluck out his poor old eyes, nor thy fierce sister in his anointed flesh stick boarish fangs. But I shall see the winged vengeance overtake such children!
See it shalt thou never
give
appalled.
Me some help!
One side will mock another, the other two!
You see vengeance!
Hold your hand, my lord! I have served you ever since I was a child, but better service have I never done you than now, to bid you home.
How now, you dog?
What do you mean?
My villain?
Nay, then come on and take the chance of anger.
Peasant, stand up thus!
Oh, my lord, you have one eye left to see some mischief on him. No!
Blessed it may. Prudence! Thy luster now.
Oh, dark and comfortless. Where is my son, Edmund? Edmund! Enkindle all the sparks of nature to quit this horrid act!
Thou treacherous villain! Thou callest on him that hates thee. Was he that made thy overtures of thy treasons to us?
Oh, my follies. Then...
Edgar was abused. Oh, kind gods, forgive me that and prosper him.
Go thrust him out of the gates. Let him smell his way to Dover.
How is it, my lord?
I have received a hurt. Turn that eyeless villain out of doors. Throw that slave upon the dunghill. Three can I beat apace? Untimely comes this hurt. Give me your arm.
I'll never care what wickedness I do if this man or woman come to good.
Let us follow the old earl and get the bedlam to lead him where he would.
Go thou. I'll fetch some plights and whites of eggs to apply to his bloody face. Now, heaven help him! Yet better thus, and known to be contemned, than still contemned and flattered. To be worse, the lowest and most dejected thing of fortune stands still in his own hope, lives not in fear. The lamentable change is from the best, the worst returns to laughter. Welcome, then, thou insubstantial air which I embrace. The wretch that thou hast blown unto the worst owes nothing to thy blasts. But who comes here? My father, poorly led. World. World, oh, world.
Oh, my good lord!
Oh, away! Get thee away! Be gone! Thy comforts can do me no good at all!
Lack, sir, you cannot see your way.
I have no way, and therefore want no eyes. I stumbled when I saw, oh, dear son Edgar, the food of thy abused father's wrath. Might I but live to see thee in my touch, I'd say I had eyes again.
Oh, how now? Who's there?
Gods, who wist can say I am the worst. I am worse than e'er I was.
'Tis poor mad Tom.
How can this be? Bad is the trade that must play fool to sorrow. Bless thee, master. Is that the naked fellow?
Aye, my lord.
Then prithee, get thee gone. Do it for ancient love, and bring me some covering for this naked soul who I'll entreat to lead me.
Alack, sir, he is mad.
'Tis the time's plague when madmen lead the blind. Do as I bid thee, or rather do thy pleasure. Oh, Pebble Rest, get thee gone!
I'll bring him the best peril that I have. Come of it what will.
Sirrah! Naked fellow! Tom's a cold. I cannot daub it any further. Come hither, fellow! And yet I must. Bless thy sweet eyes, master. They bleed.
Dost thou know the way to Dover?
Both stile and gate, horseway and footpath. Poor Tom hath been scared out of his five wits. Bless thee, good man's son, from the foul fiend. So bless thee, master.
Here,
Take this purse. Knowest thou the way to Dover?
Aye, master.
There is a cliff whose high and bending head looks fearfully in the confined deep. Bring me but to the very brim of it, and I'll repair the misery thou dost bear with something rich about me. From that place I shall no leading need.
Give me your arm. Poor Tom shall lead thee.
Welcome, my lord. I marvel our mild husband not met us on the way. Now. Where's your master?
Madam, within. But never man so changed. I told him of the army that was landed. He smiled at it. I told him you were coming. His answer was the worse. Of Gloucester's treachery and of the loyal service of his son, when I informed him, then he called me sot. Told me I had turned the wrong side out. What most he should dislike seems pleasant to him. What like offensive.
Back, Edmund, to Cornwall. Hasten his musters and conduct his powers. I must change arms at home and give the distaff into my husband's hands. This trusty servant shall pass between us ere long you are like to hear a mistress's command. Wear this. Spare speech. Decline your head. This kiss, if it durst speak, conceive, and fare thee well.
Yours, in the ranks of death.
My most dear Gloucester. Oh, the difference of man and man. To thee, a woman's service is our due. A fool usurps my bed.
Oh, Goneril!
You are not worth the dust which the rude wind blows in your face.
Oh, no more, the text is foolish.
What have you done? Tigers, not daughters. What have you performed? A father and a gracious aged man.
Milk-livered man. That bears a cheek for blows, a head for wrongs. That hast not in thy brow an eye, discerning thine honor from thy suffering. Where's thy drum? France spreads his banners in our royal land. With plumed helm thy slayer begins threats, whilst thou, a moral fool, sittest still and say, oh, why does he so?
See thyself, devil. Proper deformity seems not in the fiend so horrid as in woman.
Oh, vain fool. Marry thy manhood! Mew!
The Duke of Cornwall's dead, slain by a servant going to put out the other eye of Gloucester.
Gloucester's eyes?
A servant there opposed against the act did bend his sword to his great master, who thereat enraged, flew upon him and felled him dead, but not without that harmful stroke which hath plucked him after.
This shows you are above, you justicers, that these are nether crimes so speedily convenge. But, oh, poor Gloucester, lost he his other eye.
Both, my lord. This letter, madam, craves a speedy answer. 'Tis from your sister.
In one way, I like this well. But being widow and my Edmund with her, may all the power of my fancy pluck out my hateful life. Another way? Another way the news is not so tart. I'll read and answer.
Where was Edmund when they did take his eyes?
Oh, come my lady hither.
He's not here.
I know, my lord. I met him back again.
Knows he the wickedness?
Aye, my lord. 'Twas he informed against him, and quit the house on purpose that their punishment might take the freer course.
Gloucester, I live to thank thee for the love thou showedst the king, and to revenge thine eyes. Come, friend, tell me what more thou knowest.
Alack, 'tis he. Seek for him. Search every acre in the high-grown field and bring him to our eye. He that helps him, take all my outward worth.
News, madam! The British forces are marching hitherward.
'Tis known before. Our preparation stands in expectation of them. Oh, dear father, it is thy business that I go about. Therefore, great France, my mourning and importuned tears hath pitied. No blown ambition doth our arms incite, but love, dear love, and our aged father's right. Soon may I hear and see him.
Lord Edmund, speak not with your lord at home.
No, madam.
What might import my sister's letter to him?
I know not, lady.
Faith, he has posted hence on serious matter. It was great ignorance, Gloucester's eyes being out, to let him live. Where he arrives, he moves all hearts against us. Edmund, I think, is gone in pity of his misery to dispatch his knighted life.
I must needs after him, madam, with my letter.
Why should she write to Edmund? Might not you transport her purposes by word, be like something I know not what? I love thee much. Let me unseal the letter.
Madam, I had rather...
I know my sister does not love her husband. I am sure of that. I know you are of her bosom.
Aye, madam.
I speak in understanding. You are, I know it. Therefore, I do advise you. Take this note. My lord is dead. Edmund and I have talked, and more convenient is he for my hand than for your lady's. You may gather more. When you do see him, I pray you, give him this. And when your lady hears thus much from you, desire her, call her wisdom to her. Fare thee well. And should you happen to hear of that blind traitor, preferment falls on him that cuts him off.
Would I could meet him, madam. I should show you what party I do follow.
Fare thee well.
When shall we come to the top of that same hill?
You do climb it now. Look how we labor.
Methinks the ground is even.
Horrible steep. Hark! Do you hear the sea?
No. Truly.
Well, then thy other senses grow imperfect by thy eyes' anguish.
So may it be. Indeed, methinks thy voice is altered, and thou speakst in better phrase and matter than thou didst.
You are deceived. In nothing am I changed but in my garments.
Methinks you're better spoken.
Come on, sir. Here's the place. Stand still.
How fearful and dizzy 'tis to cast one's eyes so low. The fishermen that walk upon the beach appear like mice. Alas, I look no more, lest my brain turn and the deficient sight topple down headlong.
Set me where you stand.
Give me your hand.
You are now within a foot of the extreme verge. Let go my hand. Here, friend, it's another purse. In it, a jewel well worth a poor man's taking. Go thou farther off. Bid me farewell and let me hear thee going.
Now fare you well, good sir.
Hearty thanks.
Why I do trifle thus with his despair is done to cure it.
Oh, you mighty gods! This world I do renounce! And in your sight shake patiently my great affliction off! If I could bear it longer, if Edgar live, oh, bless him. Now, fellow, fare thee well.
And yet, I know not how conceit. Farewell. Had he been where he thought, alive or dead?
Ho, you! Sir! Hear you, sir! Speak!
Thus might he pass, indeed. Yet he revives.
What are you, sir?
Away, and let me die!
But thou dost speak. Thy life's a miracle. Speak again.
But have I fallen or no?
From the dread summit of that chalky bourne, do but look up.
Alack! I have no eyes! Is wretchedness deprived the benefit to end itself by death?
Give me your hand. Up, so. How is it? Feel you your legs. You stand.
Too well. Too well.
Therefore, thou happy.
Father, think that the clearest gods, who make them honors of man's impossibilities, have preserved thee.
I do remember now. Henceforth, I'll bear affliction till it do cry out itself, enough! Enough! And die.
Bear free and patient thoughts. But who comes here?
No, 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 no. They cannot touch me for the coining. I am the king himself.
Oh, thou sight, piercing sight.
Nature's above art in that respect. There's your press money. Oh, look, look. A mouse. Shh. This piece of toasted cheese will do it. Oh, there's my gauntlet. I'll proof it on the giant. Bring up the brown bills. Oh, well flown bird. Give the word.
Sweet Marjoram.
Oh, pass, pass.
I know that voice.
Huh? Goneril with a white beard? Well, they flattered me like a dog and told me I had white hairs in my beard. The black ones were there. To say aye and no to everything I said? Go to, they are not men of their words. They told me I was everything. 'Tis lies. I'm not ague-proof.
The trick of that voice I do well remember. Is it not the king?
Oh, I, every inch a king. When I do stare, see how the subject quakes. I pardon that man's life. What was thy cause? Adultery? Thou shalt not die. Die for adultery? No, let copulation thrive. For Gloucester's bastard son was kinder to his father than my daughters got between the lawful sheets. Behold yon simpering dame. Down from the waist she's a centaur, the woman all above. But to the girdle do the gods inherit. But beneath is all the fiends. There's hell, there's darkness, there's the sulphurous pit. Ah! Burning, scalding, stench, consumption! Fie, fie, pa, pa! Now give me an ounce of civet, good apothecary. Sweeten my imagination. Here's money for thee.
Oh, let me kiss that hand.
No. Let me wipe it first. It smells of mortality.
Oh, ruined piece of nature. Dost thou know me?
I remember thine eyes well enough. Dost thou squinny at me? Now read thou this challenge. Mark but the penning of it.
Were all the letters sons, I could not see one.
I would not take this from report. It is. And my heart breaks at it.
Oh, no eyes in your head. Yet you see how this world goes.
I see it feelingly.
What, art mad? A man may see how this world goes with no eyes. Look with thine ears. Hark in thine ear.
Aye, sir.
Or get thee glass eyes, and like a scurvy politician, seem to see what thou dost not. Oh, no. Yeah. Pull off my boots. Harder. Harder! Yes. Oh, soul.
Reason and matter mixed. Madness soul. And irrelevance.
If thou wilt weep my fortune, take my eyes. I know thee well enough. Thy name is Gloucester. Thou must be patient. We came hither crying.
Alack, alack the day.
When we are born, we die. That we are come to this great stage of fool. Oh. It is a good block. Twere a delicate stratagem, and I'll put it in proof. And when I have stolen upon these son-in-laws, then kill!
Oh, here he is! Lay hand upon him, sir, your most dear daughter.
What? A prisoner? No rescue? I'm even the natural fool of fortune. Use me well, you shall have ransom. Let me have surgeons. I'm cut to the brains.
You shall have anything.
No seconds? Myself alone. Why, that would make a man of salt. Use his eyes for garden water pots.
Good sir,
But I will die bravely, like a bridegroom. What? I will be jovial. Come. I am a king, masters. Know ye that?
You are a royal one, and we obey you.
There's life in't. And you get it? Huh? You get it by running!
A sight most pitiful and the meanest wretch. Hast speaking of in a king. He hast one daughter who redeems nature from the general curse. The queen, on special cause, is here. Her army near and on most speedy foot.
You ever gentle gods, take my breath from me. Let not my worst spirit tempt me again to die before you please.
Well, pray you, father. Give me your hand. I'll lead you to some biding.
Hearty thanks.
A precious prize. Most happy. Oh, that eyeless head of thine was first framed flesh to raise my fortunes. Thou old, unhappy traitor. Briefly thyself remember. The sword is out that must destroy thee.
No, let thy friendly hand put strength enough to it.
Wherefore, bold peasant, darest thou support a published traitor?
Nay, come not near the old man, or I shall be plain with you.
Out!
Dunhill!
Slave!
Slave me!
Villain! Take my purse! If ever thou wilt thrive, bury my body. Take the letters that thou wilt find about me to Edmund, Earl of Gloucester. Find him amongst the English party. Untimely death. Death.
I know thee well, a serviceable villain, as duteous to the vices of thy mistress as badness would desire.
What? Is he dead?
Set you down, father. Rest you. Let's see these pockets. The letters that he speaks of may be my friends. He's dead. Leave. Gentle manners.
You have many opportunities to cut him off. There is nothing done if he return. The conqueror, then am I the prisoner, and his bed my jail, from the loathed warmth whereof deliver me, and supply the place for your labor. Goneril. A plot upon her virtuous husband's life, and the exchange, my brother.
The king is mad. Of my huge sorrows, better I were distract. So should my thoughts be severed from my griefs.
Well, pray you, father. Far off, methinks I hear the beaten drum. Give me your hand, I'll bestow you with a friend.
Oh, thou good Kent. How will I ever live and work to match thy goodness? My life will be too short, and every measure fail me.
To be acknowledged is o'erpaid.
All my reports go with the modest truth, nor more, nor clipped, but so.
Be better suited. Oh, these weeds are memories of those worser hours. I prithee, put them off.
Pardon me, madam. Yet to be known shortens my made intent. I make it my boon that you know me not, till time and I think meet.
Then be it so, my good lord. How does the king?
Madam, sleep still.
Oh, my dear father. Restoration. Hang my medicine on my lips and let this kiss repair those violent harms that my two sisters have in thy reverence made.
Kind and dear princess.
Had you not been their father, these white flakes had challenged pity of them. Was this a face to be opposed against the warring winds? Mine enemy's dog, though he had bit me, should have stood that night against my fire. Alack, alack, he wakes. Speak to him.
Madam, do you? 'Tis fittest.
How does my royal lord? How fares your majesty?
To do me wrong, to take me out of the grave. Thou art a soul in bliss. But I am bound upon a wheel of fire that mine own tears do scald like molten lead.
Sir, do you know me?
You are a spirit, I know.
You are a spirit, I know.
Still.
When did
still
you die?
Still far wide.
He's scarce
still
awake.
Far wide.
Let him alone a while. He's scarce awake, madam. Let him alone a while.
Where have I been?
Where am I?
Huh? Where am I?
Fair daylight.
Oh, fair daylight.
I am mightily abused.
I should even die with pity to see another such. I know not what to say. I will not swear these are my hands.
Let's see.
I feel the pinprick. Would I were assured of my condition.
Oh, look upon me, sir, and hold your hands in benediction o'er me. No, sir, you must not kneel.
No. Pray do not mock me. I am a very foolish, fond old man, fourscore and upward, not an hour more or less. And to deal plainly, I fear I am not in my perfect mind. Methinks I should know you. And know this man. Yet I am doubtful, for I am mainly ignorant what place this is. Now all the skill I have remembers not these garments, nor know I not where I did lodge last night. Do not laugh at me, for as I am a man, I think this lady to be my child. Cordelia?
And so I am. I am.
Be your tears wet? Yes, Faith. Pray you weep not.
If you have poison for me, I will drink it. I know you do not love me, for your sisters have, as I do remember, done me wrong. You have some cause, they have not.
No cause, no cause.
Am I in France?
In your own kingdom, sir.
Do not abuse me.
Be comforted, good madam. The great rage you see is killed in him. Desire him not to go in.
Wilt please your highness walk?
But you must bear with me. I pray you now forget and forgive. I'm old and foolish.
Holds it true, sir, that the Duke of Cornwall was so slain?
Most certain, sir.
And who was conductor of his people?
As 'tis said, the bastard son of Gloucester.
They say Edgar, his banished son, is with the Earl of Kent in Germany.
Report is changeable. 'Tis time to look about. All the powers of the kingdom approach apace.
The arbitrament is like to be bloody. Fare you well, sir.
My point and period will be throughly wrought, or well or ill, as this day's battle's fought.
Know of the Duke if his last purpose hold.
My sister's man is certainly miscarried.
'Tis to be doubted, madam.
Now, sweet lord, you know the goodness I intend upon you. Tell me, but truly, but speak the truth. Do you not love my sister?
In honored love.
But have you never found my brother's way to the forfended place?
That thought abuses you.
I am doubtful you have been conjunct and bosomed with her and all as we call hers.
No. By mine honor, madam.
I cannot endure her. Dear my lord, be not familiar with her.
Fear me not. She and the Duke, her husband.
I had rather lose the battle than that sister should loosen him and me.
Our very loving sister, well be met. Sir, this have I heard. The king is come to his daughter with others whom just causes make oppose.
Sir, you speak nobly.
Why is this reasoned?
Combined together against the enemy. For these domestic and particular broils are not the question here.
Let's then determine with the Ancient of War in our proceedings.
I shall attend you presently at your tent.
Sister, you'll go with us?
No.
'Tis most convenient, I pray you, go with us.
Oh, I know the riddle. I will go.
If e'er your grace had speech with man so poor, hear me one word.
Speak.
Before you fight the battle, ope this letter. If you have victory, let the trumpet cry for him that sent it. Wretched though I seem, I can produce a champion that will prove what is avouched there. Fortune love you.
Stay till I have read the letter.
I was forbid it. Let but the trumpet cry, when time shall serve, and I'll appear again.
Why, fare thee well. I will o'erlook thy paper.
The enemy's in view! Draw up your powers!
We will greet the time!
To both these sisters
have I sworn my love. Each jealous of the other as the stung are of the adder. Which of them shall I take? Both? One? Or neither? Neither can be enjoyed if both remain alive. To take the widow exasperates, makes mad her sister Goneril, and hardly shall I carry out my side, her husband being alive. Now then, we'll use his countenance for the battle, which being done, let her who would be rid of him devise his speedy taking off. As for the mercy which he intends to Lear and to Cordelia, the battle done, and they within our power shall never see his pardon. For my state stands on me to defend, not to debate.
Here, Father, take the shadow of this stone for your good comfort. Pray that the rites may thrive. If ever I return to you again, I'll bring you better comfort.
Oh, Grace, go with you, sir.
Away, old man! Give me thy hand away! King Lear hath lost. He and his daughter Tain. Give me thy hand, come on!
No, father, sir, a man may rot even here!
What an ill spirit again! Men must endure their going hence even as they're coming hither. Ripeness is all come on!
Some officers take them away. Good guard, until their greater pleasures first be known that are to censure them.
We are not the first.
With best meaning have incurred the worst. For thee, oppressed king, am I cast down? Shall we not see these daughters and these sisters?
Oh, no, 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 no. Come. Let's away to prison. We two alone will sing like birds of the cage. When thou dost ask for blessing, I'll kneel down and ask of thee forgiveness. Sing, tell old tales, and laugh at gilded butterflies, and hear poor rogues talk of court news. We'll talk with them too. Who loses and who wins, who's in, who's out, and take upon us the mystery of things as if we were God's spies.
Take them away!
No, no, no. He that parts us shall bring a brand from heaven. Now, wipe thine eyes. Come.
Come hither, Captain. Hark. Take thou this note. Go follow them to prison.
If thou dost as this instructs thee, thou dost make thy way to noble fortunes. Thy employment will not bear question. Either say thou do it, or thrive by other means.
I'll do it, my lord.
About it instantly, and carry it so as I have set down.
If it be man's work, I'll do it.
Sir, you have shown today your valiant strain, and fortune led you well. You have the captives, which were the opposite of this day's strife. We do require them of you.
Sir, I thought it fit to send the old and miserable king to some retention and appointed guard. With him I sent the queen, my reason all the same, and they are ready tomorrow, or at further space to appear where you shall hold your session. At this time, the question of Lear and of Cordelia requires a fitter place.
Sir, by your leave, I hold you but a subject of this war, not as a brother.
That's as we list to grace him. He led our powers, bore the commission of my place and purpose, the which immediacy may well stand up and call itself your brother.
Not so hot. In his own grace, he doth exalt himself more than in your addition.
By my rights, by me invested, he compeers the best.
That would be most, if you should husband him.
Jesters do oft prove prophets.
Oh, la. Oh, la.
Lady, I am not well, else I should answer from a full-flowing stomach. General, witness the world that I create thee here, my lord and master.
Mean you to enjoy him?
Let the drum strike and prove my title thine.
Stay yet, hear reason. Edmund, I arrest thee on capital treason. And in thine attaint, this gilded serpent. For your claim, fair sister, I bar it in the interest of my wife. 'Tis she is subcontracted to this lord.
Oh, an interlude.
Gloucester, thou art armed. Let the trumpet sound. If none appear, to prove upon thy head thy heinous, manifest, and many treasons, there is my pledge.
Oh, sick!
If not, I'll ne'er trust medicine.
There's my exchange. What in the world he is that names me traitor? Villain-like he lies. Call by thy trumpet. He that dares approach on him, on you, who not? I will maintain my truth and honor firmly.
My sickness arose upon me.
Draw thy sword. Thou art a villain. False to thy gods, thy brother and thy father. Conspirant against this high, illustrious prince. What are you? Your name, your quality? No, my name is lost by treason's tooth. Yet am I noble as the adversary I come to cope. Back! Do I toss these treasons to thy head? With a hell-hated lie o'erwhelm thy heart, which for they at glance by and scarcely bruise, this sword of mine shall give them instant way where they shall rest forever. Trumpet, speak!
Mouth, dame. Or with this paper shall I stop it? Hold, sir. Thou worse than any name.
Read thine own evil. No tearing, lady. I perceive you know it.
So what if I do? The laws are mine, not thine. Who will arraign me for it?
Most monstrous! Oh, knowst thou this paper?
Ask me not what I know.
What you have charged me with, that have I done. And more, much more. The time will bring it out. 'Tis past, and so am I. But what art thou that hast this fortune on me? If thou art noble, I do forgive thee.
My name is Edgar, and thy father's son. The dark and vicious place where thee he got cost him his eyes.
Thou hast spoken right. 'Tis true. The wheel is come full circle. I am here.
She's dead. Your lady, sir. Your lady and her sister by her is poisoned. She hath confessed it.
I was contracted to them both. All three now marry in an instant.
Here comes Kent. The banished Kent who in disguise followed his enemy king and did him service.
I am come to bid my king and master aye good night. Is he not here?
Great thing of us forget. Speak, Edmund. Where's the king? And where's Cordelia?
Yet Edmund was beloved. The one the other poisoned for my sake and after slew herself. I pant for life. Some good I mean to do despite of mine own nature. Quickly send, be brief in it to the castle, for my writ is on the life of Lear and on Cordelia. Nay, send in time!
Who hath the office?
The captain.
Haste thee, for thy life!
He hath commission from thy wife and me to hang Cordelia in the prison and to lay the blame upon her own despair that she fordid herself.
Oh, the gods defend her.
Oh, how? 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 Oh, how? Oh, you are men of stone. Had I your tongue eyes, I use them so that heaven's vault should crack. Oh, she's gone forever. Know when one is dead and when one lives. She's dead as earth. Oh, lend me a looking glass. If that her breath should mist or stain the stone, why then she lives.
Is this the promised end?
Or image of that horror?
Fallen cease.
This feather stirs. She lives. If it be so, it is a chance that does redeem all sorrow that ever I have felt.
Oh, my good master.
Plague upon you! Murderers! Traitors all! I might have saved her. But now she's gone forever. Oh, Cordelia. Cordelia, stay a little. What is thou sayest? Her voice was ever soft, gentle, and low. An excellent thing in woman. I killed the slave that was a hanging thee.
'Tis true, my lords. He did.
Did I not, fellow? Who are you? Mine eyes are not of the best. Are you not Kent?
The same. Your servant, Kent.
Edmund is dead, my lord.
That's but a trifle here. You lords and noble friends know our intent. What comfort to this great decay may come shall be applied. For us, we will resign during the life of this old majesty to him our absolute power. All friends shall taste the wages of their virtues, and all foes the cup of their deservings. Oh, see, see.
My poor fool is hanged. No, no! No life. Why should a dog, a horse, a rat have life and thou no breath at all? Thou'lt come no more. Never, never, never. Never, never. pray you unto. Thank you, sir. Oh, do you see this? Look on her. Look. Her lips. Look there. Look!
He faints.
There.
My lord. My lord.
Oh, break heart. I prithee break.
Rise up, my lord.
Vex not his ghost. Oh, let him pass. He hates him much that would upon the rack of this tough world stretch him out longer.
He is gone, indeed.
The wonder is he hath endured so long.
Our present business is general woe. Friends of my soul, you twain rule in this realm, and the gored state sustain.
I have a journey, sir, shortly to go. My master calls me. I must not say no.
The weight of this sad time we must obey. Speak what we feel, not what we ought to say. The oldest hath borne most. We that are young shall never see so much, nor live so long.
Mm-hmm.